Hey guys, it's Will from EDM Tips. I'm super excited to be interviewing a producer today called JOLYON PETCH. He's a New Zealand producer living in Australia, and his latest track, Dreams, has been at the top of the charts in Australia for many weeks now, and it's even crossed into the mainstream, and it's competing against the likes of Ed Sheeran, Jay-Z, and Justin Bieber. So today we're gonna have a free-ranging conversation talking about what it takes to grow yourself as an artist, production techniques, shooting the shit about doors, and the roller coaster emotional ride of competing against some of the world's biggest artists. Don't forget to check out JOLYON's track Dreams by clicking the link below this video after you've watched this interview. And without further ado, let's hop into that free-ranging conversation with JOLYON PETCH.
JOLYON, thank you very much for joining us on the channel today. It's really good to see you again, man.
Fantastic, man. It's a pleasure to be here. The last time saw you was Gold Coast.
It was indeed, yeah.
That was a long time ago.
That was probably 10 years or something like that, maybe a bit less.
Yeah, I left Gold Coast in 2013, so you were probably there 2012, 2011 or something like that. So yeah, man, it's been a long time.
It has indeed. So yeah, you're originally from New Zealand, but you're based in Melbourne in Australia, and you're having some great success at the moment. You've been cranking out great tracks for years. But yeah, the latest track that you've made, Dreams, has really blown up. You know, it's been number one in the ARIA charts for what, 7 weeks now?
It started off on the ARIA Club charts, which was, we spent 7 weeks at the top spot. It's still in the ARIA Club charts, and I think it's almost 28 or 29 weeks later. So it's, I think it's in the 30s or maybe the late 20s, but from the ARIA Club charts, which is the Australian national club charts, what's popping in the clubs, it's actually crossed over onto the main charts, which was my first time ever being in the main charts over here, which is massive, you know. So now I'm actually, instead of being up against big dance acts from Australia and around the world, I'm actually up against the Ed Sheerans and the Justin Biebers and the pop stars now. So it's a completely different world, which I've jumped into, which has been amazing to see the roller coaster that I've been on for this. Considering I've come from dance music land where, you know, I'm just competing against dance music producers and songs like that for charts. But now it's like, you know, you get onto these main charts. We peaked at number 16 a few weeks ago, and, you know, which is absolutely crazy for me. And we're number two on the Australian singles charts as well, just behind Kid Leroy and Justin Bieber, which is like one of the biggest songs in the world at the moment. Absolutely. So to be kind of up against them is crazy. But then, you know, we thought, oh, we're going to jump up higher. And then Kanye West releases his album, and it's like 20 something songs in there, and then bang, they're shooting into the singles chart, even though some of them aren't singles, but because people are listening to them, streaming them, downloading them. So then they kind of push back, and then the next week Drake releases his album. So yeah, it's just so hard when you're up against all the pop stars. But it's been a journey, and I'm very blessed for my song to have crossed over.
Yeah, well, I give you an absolute heartfelt congratulations, because that's fantastic, man. That's the dream of many a dance music producer, you know, to get to that level where you are competing against the world's biggest artists.
Yeah, and it gives you a little bit of credibility at the end where you're going, oh, okay, my music can be on a world stage like some of these guys, you know, and it's only released on an independent label over here called Hustle Recordings. You know, and we're competing against the Sonys and the Warner Music, the Universal, so, and the EMIs and all that. So it's a fantastic journey to be on from where I've come from, and it kind of gives you a new strategy of where I want to place myself now, coming off a big Australian New Zealand radio hit like that. And yeah, I think it's actually starting to pop over in your neck of the woods as well. So that's the next thing, is the whole international build-up of promotion for it.
Excellent. Well, I'll be linking to the track below this video as well, so people should go and check it out.
Check it out, please.
So, the guys who watch this channel are well into music production. That's what we do. So they've given me a bunch of questions. So that's why I'm checking on my phone, because that's where they're listed. You are also a club DJ as well. Obviously, that's had to be knocked on the head for the time being because of the COVID situation. But what's that relationship between writing music and then playing it out in the clubs? How does it feel to see people reacting to your own music?
Well, I mean, that's where it all started from. I came from a DJ point of view. Before that, I was playing drums in a band. So when I came to DJing, all it is the beat matching. So as a drummer, that was just easy to me. But when I started, I was on vinyl. So there was no BPM things that for the CDJs like they have nowadays. You had to use your ear training for that. Once I progressed into the music production, then putting that over so I can actually play that out in my sets and actually seeing the reaction of these tracks. It's an amazing feeling, especially playing to massive crowds and crowds singing your songs back to you as well. I mean, you can't beat that.
I saw a video, I think, on your Facebook channel of people singing Dreams back to you.
That was the first time I'd played it out as well. There was a little Instagram video I took, and it was just a small venue, and it was, I think it was a Thursday night, and I think it was actually a Thursday night, and then the next day we went into a lockdown. And, people were just, we'd been in lockdown for so long over here, so for us DJs getting out, it was such a privilege to get back out there and play, for all these kids. And I dropped it, and man, for the first time actually hearing everyone, and it was the first time they'd heard, okay, they know the song, it's an old Fleetwood Mac track, and it had got big on TikTok, but to actually go there and play my version of it for the first time and get that reaction, I was like, wow, I've got something special here. And this was before it was even released. I actually did a Head Candy live stream. And on the live stream, I was getting all these people going, oh, what remix is this? And then people private messaging me. I was like, oh, there could be something to this, tinkered away a little bit more. And then, signed it. And here we are.
Excellent stuff. Cool. So, I'll start going through these questions from the guys.
Cool.
It's a bit that some of them are more production, some of them are regarding marketing and, artist profile and stuff like that. So I've just got them in no particular order, but the first one, and also apologies to whoever asked these questions because I haven't actually made a note of the name, but whatever. Do you market yourself, and how much, and the second, I think this is from Jack Parker actually, and how much time do you spend say marketing versus actually the production side of things?
Well, I guess if I'm self-releasing something, I spend a little bit of money on marketing. But, if you're signing to a record label, they're basically handling the marketing. I mean, is that question about marketing my music or marketing myself as a DJ or music producer?
It's unclear from what he's written, but I think you've answered it in terms of what the labels will do. But in terms of your own personal profile, I guess, as an artist.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not one of the younger generation of guys that, a lot of, there's two types of DJs. You've got the guys that are kind of for the image, and then you've got the guys that are passionate about the music. And I'm just passionate about the music, So I just kind of, at the end of the day, I let the music speak for me. I think the key, if you really want to have that marketing of becoming a bigger DJ, you have to get in with one of these good labels, and they will take care of the marketing because they've got the hookups to radio, they've got the hookups to TV, they've got the hookups to newspapers, all websites, blogs, all that type of stuff, channels like yourself, labels have all, they've got guys that do that all the time. As an artist, I want to be focused on making music rather than doing the marketing side of things. And so at the moment, for me, I've actually got a management team that will say, right, you need to do some Instagram posts here and some Facebook things here, and maybe we'll do a little bit of spend here for your next single. You know, everything, as I kind of said earlier, my strategy has changed now off the back of the success of Dreams. So pre-having a hit song, I had a different mentality, and I actually was going to have 10, I was looking at trying to get 10 JOLYON PETCH singles out this year. Before Dreams, I had one called Holding on Central Station. After Dreams and Dreams, I got, I think, released in April or May. Haven't had a single since then. And I probably won't have a single till the new year.
Is that due to not having written any, or because the label Hustle said, let's ride this out rather than, you know?
Well, when you cross over onto the main charts, you know, my Spotify streams now, like I'm getting 100,000 streams a day. More than that, you know, it just depends on what time of the week, what day of the week you've got all the people listening in on. So, you know, you get to a million, you know, some weeks you can get a million in 1 week, you know, and it's just kind of crazy like that. So I kind of see pre having the hit, I would like to have my song come out with, say, 5 remixes. Or 4 remixes, you know, that helps on getting on club charts and stuff like that, because you know, there might be a tech house remix and there might be a drum and bass remix or whatever, you know, it's more of your song getting out into different dance floors and more people are hearing it. Yeah. So, but now when you have that hit song, if you have some other remixes that start doing well, they take stream count away from your main song. Yeah. So realistically, you want your main song to have like 100 million streams.
Yeah,
but you know, some of the other remixes might get, you know, take a million or so, or a couple million off that, you know, and you're kind of wanting your main mix to have the most. So, yeah, the strategy for me has changed quite a bit now. And I think also when you're getting into the top of the charts, you want to give your single a bit of time to get up the top, because if you put another single that comes out and radio goes, oh, we like this single, okay, we're going to stop playing Dreams now and the next one comes in. So you're kind of, you know, I want to try and get Dreams to a top 10 in Australia if I can, you know, and so does the label. You know, we've already got to a gold record now, so the next is platinum. And I think that's the whole thing, is you just, as much as I've got so much music that I could put out tomorrow and the next day and the next day and the next day, you've got to think when you get to that point, you want to try and ride it for as long as you can, you know?
Yeah.
But like I have other aliases. So I have actually put music out, but under my other alias, Electric Disco.
Yeah.
And one of my Electric Disco singles was actually meant to be a JOLYON PETCH thing, but we just thought for the best thing for that record is release it under one of my other names. I did a JOLYON PETCH remix, so I'm still in the mix of it. Yeah. But yeah, when you've got something that's really popping and it's your first time that's crossing over on, you know, it was actually the number one most played song on Australian radio for 6 weeks in a row, beating Ed Sheeran, Justin Bieber, all those guys. Like, that is absolutely crazy.
That's insane, man. That's fantastic, though.
So a little old Kiwi boy from New Zealand, you know, a population of, what have we got there, 4 million in our entire country.
Wow.
You know, to be the most played artist on Australian radio for 6 weeks in a row, that's crazy. And we're on the top of the New Zealand radio charts as well, number 3 or something for the last 3 weeks. So
they must love you over there.
Well, I haven't been able to get back home because of COVID, unfortunately, but hoping I'm double vaxxed now, so hopefully we can get across the ditch and catch up with friends and family.
Well, Yeah, that's when you've got like someone who does well from a small place, generally it's a big deal. I mean, I'm from the Isle of Wight, so that's a pretty small place, smaller than New Zealand, in fact. But, you know, when someone kind of like, I think Anthony Minghella was from here, he's like a film producer. And like when someone makes it big, we're like, yes, go for it, mate.
I can't wait to actually get back home. And I've had a lot of old friends that I haven't seen in years, you know, they'll message me or send a video of the song playing on radio, and, you know, people are freaking out, and people I haven't heard from in years. And it's been nice, especially because of the circumstance of COVID and being locked down. You know, it's I'm not able to go out, but hearing from a lot of people that I haven't heard from in years, it does mean a lot.
Yeah. Oh, that's really good. Cool. Okay. So the next question is, how long would you say you were producing for until you felt that you were actually making good quality tracks?
That's a good question.
You're thinking back a while now because you've been producing a long time.
Yeah. I am very critical of my music. Gosh, I don't know. I'd say probably since I got to Melbourne and signed with Vicious Records over here, then I really kind of took my music production a lot more seriously, got in the studio with a couple of bigger music producers, just so, because I'm self-taught, you know, and you always have a little bit of self-doubt, even through, you know, DJ, I'll be playing my songs and I get good reactions, but I always, there is that self-doubt in the back of my mind. So when I ended up meeting up with Kid Creme, who's an absolute house legend, and we ended up working together, and I was kind of watching what he was doing going, okay, I'm not that far off from there. So I'd say, and also when I was doing stuff with Esquire as well, from the UK, he's like super quick with loops and all this, whereas Kid Creme comes from that old school kind of the fundamentals of like sampling off records and all that kind of stuff. So
yeah,
I would say probably around the 2015 time is where my music production really upped itself, and I was working with some other good mixing engineers and mastering engineers that could take it to that next level, because I don't profess to be a great mixing engineer or mastering engineer. I can if I want, but it just means I'm going to add on more and more days because I'm such a perfectionist and I critique my music, and then you go and play it in the club and like, oh, maybe the kick drum's not right, so go back and test out another one. So, but I think from 2015 on, I've been the most proud of my music then.
Cool. And how long have you been producing in total, would you say?
Well, would you include me recording with a band when I was young?
I don't know, actually, because I've been in a few
progressing
bands.
To electronic dance music.
Yeah, I'd say electronic dance music.
Okay. So in 2001, I produced, with the help of an engineer, a trance track, and it was an abomination. But it made it onto a CD in New Zealand for a compilation record that I mixed for a music promotion company here, which was actually going through BMG Records back in the day. So it was my first attempt at making music, and I had all these tracks that I loved, and I took all these different elements from the tracks, and it sounds like it's three or four tracks in one. So yeah, it's an abomination.
So until you reach that 2015 point, you know, that's 14 years of slogging away until you really felt like, okay, now my music really sounds good enough.
Well, I mean, from 2001, there was, that was my first forte into it. Then I started dabbling in Reason.
Love Reason.
And Reason was cool because, you know, you could rewire things in and all that kind of stuff.
Great fun to use, yeah.
Oh, great fun. So that was my first DAW, and I was messing about on there. And then I think we actually, another studio mate who was, he was using Pro Tools, he was, he kind of got me more, this is when I got into the housier stuff. And we did a bootleg of ELO Evil Woman. And I remember I was playing with Judge Jules, and I said, oh, I've got done this thing of ELO Evil Woman. He goes, oh, I love ELO. Oh, you got to give it to me. So I gave him a CD, you know, and then a couple of weeks later, he got back to England, and I got all these phone calls from people going, oh my God, Judge Jules has just played your main stage of Homelands. I was like, oh, wow, big festival. And so from there, people were like, oh, you know, we want more music. So in Auckland, where I'm from, where I was growing up, doing my DJing, staying out and playing all around the country, you know, I was making stuff that was okay, and it worked at the time. But, you know, if I go back and listen to it, I'm just like, that's rubbish. You know, just so much stuff that I've learned in that time. But, you know, there was some cool tracks back then. But, yeah, definitely my move to Australia was kind of where I really was like, right, if I move to Australia, I'm going to focus on music production. And I moved in 2010. So right. I started upping my game in 2010, but it was really, I went that next level at 2015.
Right. Okay, cool. I didn't realize that you'd met Judge Jules. Yeah, he was a mainstay of my growing up. You know, when I got into production, I was using Reason and listening to Judge Jules every weekend on Radio One.
And Judge Jules is how I got into DJing.
Oh, right.
So through listening to the annual, one of his very first ones, he was on disc one. Boy George was on disc two. I think it was maybe the annual four or something like that, a purple cover for Ministry of Sound. And so I would go and order those bits of vinyl and then try and mix them exactly the way that Judge Jules mixed them on the album. And that's how I taught myself to DJ, is through listening to his mixes and doing like that. And then, you know, then you start going, okay, well, if I can do it like that, I'll try some other ones. And then, you know, so he was definitely instrumental in actually turning me from kind of band music to dance music as well, because I loved his selections. And it was back in those days where it wasn't so much, oh, I'm just into house music. You know, there was, they'd start on house and they'd go into trance and sometimes even a little bit of breakbeat, you know.
Yeah,
all the genre lines were all completely blurred back then.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a lot more, I guess, open. Yeah. In the 90s.
Exactly.
You know, everyone seems to kind of be in a real niche now. And I understand why, you know, because people want to, if someone sees your name, they want to know what they're going to get, I guess.
Yeah, for sure.
Cool. So I have to keep unlocking this phone, which is annoying. What would you say is the most important thought process that you have when creating, or do you even have a process, or is it different every time you start out a new track?
Yeah, I guess it is different every time. You know, sometimes I might just go, right, I'm just going to create some drums today, and then I'll just work on some solid drum grooves. And then some days I come in going, right, I'm just going to play around the keyboard, and I might come up with two or three different riffs. Go, okay, that's cool. And then, you know, if it's for doing a remix, you know, it's what part of the stems am I going to use? Am I generally, if I do a remix, I don't use anything other than the a cappella.
Yeah.
I want completely, unless it's an amazing song that I love and there's something in it. But then, you know, I find the whole point of a remix is to just re-envisage it. And not kind, there are some guys that, you know, that if there's a big piano thing, they might do that and just have a bit of a different drop. But I just see it's too samey, you know, and I want to be completely creative. So I guess, yeah, my thought process into doing remixes might be a bit different, but if I'm just working on original stuff, you know, I'll just start with having a clap or something, clap or a kick. And it depends if I'm wanting it more bassy, then it'll be a kick and bass and we'll go from there. or it's just try and find some really nice chords or some kind of melodic thing to start with, you know?
Yeah, cool. So it's kind of different each time.
It is. It totally depends on my mood, you know?
Cool. We kind of alluded to this earlier when you mentioned that you were in the studio with Kid Creme. But this question is, were there any aha moments when it came to producing, like things that you learned that just leveled up your game? You know, if you learn something like parallel compression or like any particular thing, you're like, okay, my music sounds better after this, like one thing I've learned.
Yeah. Quite a recent little trick that is just the layering, really. You know, I never ever thought about, you know, some producers have a sub kick and a mid kick and a click kick, you know. I'm always watching and watch things off your channel and other guys' channels, and I'm always learning as well. And but also for like basses, you know, I would just find a cool sound, what I thought was cool, and you know, and that was it. But you know, really trying to find maybe another high layer and then splitting that even more stereo, and then having your sub and just EQing your sub so it's, you've got a nice thick low mono signal down the bottom of it as well, as those kind of things have really upped my game, and something that I never really thought too much about, but when I found out about it, I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, that's actually going to make things sit a lot better. And so I think for me, yeah, it's that type of production skill was maybe a year or two ago. So quite recent. Sometimes I would just have the sub bass sitting like that, but it was, I didn't think too much about the other layers on top and having like more transient stuff. But I guess it evolves with the music styles as well, you know, slap house and all that. You want to have those real punchy transients as well. So I guess it depends on what style of music you're making.
Cool. Yeah. So I guess that's what keeps this fascinating, you know, after we've been doing it for however many years, there's always new things to learn, new styles coming out. It just keeps it fresh, keeps it interesting.
Well, one thing also I learned from working with legends like Kid Creme is, you know, you're always thinking about effects as well. And he and those old school guys are very different in their approach to using effects. They're not dropping, you know, big swooshes in on stuff all the time and white noise downlifters and all this type of stuff. They're a lot more creative in the way that they go about doing stuff. So they're kind of like what you can do with like that, the Dada Life Endless Smile or the bass clef washout type of things, you know, but they would be doing this before all that was invented, you know. And there was just some cool tricks like that where they would do more off the delays and off vocals and stuff, and then putting the reverbs off that and using those as kind of, because back in those days, remember, sample packs didn't exist.
Yeah.
You know, so they're having to create these from scratch. So learning all those kind of bits and pieces was really interesting as well. And then I can apply that to what I already know and come up with some different type of things.
Cool. Yeah, I love Kid Creme, man. That remix of At Night still is an absolute tune.
And his remix of Kylie Minogue as well. I love that one as well.
Oh, I can't remember that. I'll have to check it out.
Yeah, you check it out. The bass line on that again. So for me, actually working with him, you know, I used to play him and Junior Jack's music all the time.
Yeah.
And then later on in life, I'm actually in the studio. I know both of the guys really, really well. Currently just come off remixing Junior Jack's Stupid Disco song. So for me, years later from DJing their stuff, I'm actually now officially remixing it or working in the studio with them. So stuff like that. It's just a highlight for me in my career.
Yeah. Oh, that's brilliant. So the next question is how can I do good transitions in a song? Yeah. So over and above what you just mentioned about the way that the older guys do it. Are there any particular ways that you, because I think a lot of people, and I get this question a lot, they've got, you know, perhaps their drop and they've got their verse section, or, and weaving those together into a nice arrangement, I think is a big struggle for a lot of people.
I think so. I think a lot of it comes down to good filtering as well. You know, so doing some low cutting just before your drops, and potentially even, you know, I in stem mixes, sometimes I will go through everything and I'll stem mix it. And then I will apply on the master maybe a little bit of a Endless Smile or something like that. And then I'll re-stem mix everything again, so it's all printed onto that. So, I mean, those kind of reverb washes are nice before there. But also then if you're high-passing it, maybe with a little drum fill or something like that, that's not being affected by the Endless Smile or something, you know, clap,
yes,
or reverse kick, or, you know, vocal stab or something like that, you know. Definitely transitions. It's, I mean, you can just go overboard and just put sweeps galore and then down, you know, uplifters and then downlifters, but it's just so generic and you want to be a little bit more creative in doing that as well. But in saying that, you know, sometimes it just sounds good to have those there. And if it sounds good, you know, I find if you're doing radio, stuff for radio, less is more for sure. I find for if you're building like something more of a club remix, for instance, my next single, which I'm just finishing at the moment, I'm obviously building it for radio stations now. So I don't want to have too many effects on it, because you don't need that for radio, really. You still got to have nice transitions, but less is more. But for the club mix, like when it goes into the initial breakdown, which is my intro on the radio mix, I'm going to put some white noise and I have some claps instead of having nothing there, because when you're on a dance floor, if you don't have claps, you're kind of losing the energy. So I kind of do a little bit of a separate thing for even for Spotify edits. It'll be, you know, a little bit stripped back and it'll build up. So it's more of a journey. Whereas for club records, I want that energy. I want the claps. I want, or a ride cymbal or something from the get-go, a downlifter, just something that keeps that energy going.
Yeah, that's really interesting, actually, that notion of having two different approaches for two different audiences.
Well, I think you can also master on the radio mix. Generally, you like to have your vocals a touch louder on the radio mix. And that's an old trick from producers from many years ago, is, you know, that's because you're listening to radio on totally different systems all around the world, you know, and it's the main thing is having that vocal maybe might only be 1 dB louder or 1.5, but that's another thing, is having that vocal just a little bit louder there. On the club mix, not so much.
Cool. Yeah, that's a great tip, Nat. I'm going to just stop messages pinging. And what would you say is the biggest mistake that you see new producers making?
Just copycats. Don't be a copycat. You know, that's it's easy to do, and you know, I reference a few tracks, but I might go, yeah, that's a great kick, I'm gonna work off something like that. But try and find your own sound. Don't be like, as much as you may love someone, don't try and copy them too much. Just take inspiration from what you're hearing, you know. I think producers can get stuck in a rut like that, you know, especially young guys. So I would just say, just try and find your own sound, but yeah, definitely take inspiration from the music that you love as well.
Cool. And I'm not sure how much time you've got, actually, because I don't want to, you know, I'm mindful of...
Let's get going.
Cool. Okay, man. So how... Okay. Well, this question is, how do you promote yourself organically and properly, especially in the age of bot streams and other sketchy ways to kind of fake it till you make it? And we already touched upon the fact that if you're with a label, they're going to be handling that kind of thing. Is there anything else that you could add to that about how not to, how to promote yourself without resorting to dodgy ways of doing it that you really shouldn't be doing?
It's a difficult one, especially if you're starting out. You know, it is very difficult because there's just so many guys putting out music now. And, you know, back in the day, it was actually hard to get songs out on like Juno or Beatport or any of those classic sites. Now it just seems that anyone can just, you know, sign onto DistroKid or something like that and get something out. So I would say really focus on your branding to start with and get your brand to a really good caliber, get some good artwork. I mean, you can find some reasonably cheap guys on the Fiverr website as well. You know, they can do up some really cool art or some great logos. Get your imagery looking really schmicko, you know, and then, you know, don't like spam artists all the time, but, you know, if you think you've got something that's just absolutely amazing, you know, just send a message to an artist that you like saying, hey man, I'm big fan of yours, you know, just let us know if you've got any new music and start off a little rapport and don't just go, hey man, here's my new track and just blast some guy. And it's like, man, I don't know who you are. And I get hundreds of emails a day and chats and stuff. So be, treat it like, even if you don't think the guy's like a David Guetta or something, like you're not going to go to David Guetta going, hey man, I've got the track that you need to play right now, you know? So just be cool and just treat, guys where you can just come in on a friendly basis, and then once you've got a rapport with them, they go, hey, would you mind if I like sent you over a track? And then they're like, yeah, sure, you know, and get some feedback, and then you might get one of the guys going, hey, I really like this, I'm going to start playing it. And then, you know, if you get a bigger DJ playing your songs out there, then, you know, you're going to get more people listening to it and potentially get it signed to a better label, or have another label that you like go, hey, we really like this track that he's playing. We know it's released, but have you got anything else? You know, and that's actually what I'm finding now is with Dreams, I'm getting like these massive labels that turn me down multiple times now all coming to me going, have you got any new tracks that we can listen to? It's like, oh, you want a piece of me now, do you?
Isn't that the way?
Yeah.
There are some great tips in there. And I fully get the being respectful of people. The amount of emails I get from people just saying, listen to this track, give me feedback. It's like, no.
Well, the thing is, I mean, I could start up a website and go, yeah, I'll give you my feedback, but it's going to cost you $100 for me to listen to it, because time is money, you know. It's like we're all trying to get there, but you know, it is a hard road. And I've it's taken me 20 odd years to, you know, I wasn't producing the whole time, but out DJing and all that, but 20 years of hard slog, and coming from a generation where there were no YouTube tutorials on how to make music or anything like that, you know, we would bring DJs people like the Freemasons. I'd bring the Freemasons over to New Zealand while I've got them there. It's like, hey, James, how do I do this and how do I do that? And that's how I was getting my information from guys that I love their music, and they were giving tips and tricks like that. So, be careful with, don't hit guys too hard on your opening message. Just, you know, go in there a bit cooler. You're really hyped. Oh, you want someone to listen to your music, but seriously, the amount of music that is out there now is just so recyclable as well. So just be cool. And if you think you've got a really amazing track, especially the other thing is research the guy that you want to send music to, because lots of guys will send me stuff, especially for my record labels. It's like they almost haven't even listened to the music that comes out on the record label. It's yeah. like they send me like a progressive trance track or something. Like, when does my disco house record label put out progressive trance? You know, so yeah. it's like you need to really research, because at the end of the day, if you're wasting somebody's time, even if it's 30 seconds just to, you know, they've taken the time to listen to that, and then it's like, then they haven't even listened to my record label. They've just found my email and done that. So just be cool, I think, when you're reaching out to artists that you want them to be playing your music. I think that's a very big, important tip.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's brilliant advice. Knowing your audience and being respectful.
Yeah.
Cool. Cool. And then, so this is a good one, actually. Knowing what you now know, if you could speak to Jolyon from 20 years ago, what tips would you give yourself?
As much as I hate it, this part of it is get your contracts, get them watertight, get a contract. If you're in the studio with five people, you need to work out your splits and all that, because down the road it can get messy. I mean, when you're starting out, you probably don't think anything about that, and it's just, oh, I've got the passion for music and all that. But when you progress through, you really want to get your all the back end stuff sorted. That's the main thing for me, is just make sure you've got your paperwork sorted for all that.
Okay.
That's an important thing.
Cool. So yes, take note, everyone. Take note. Excuse me. This cold does my head in. we're drawing to an end of the questions now, but this isn't the question anyone's asked, but I get it a lot in my masterclass from my students, is where do you find vocalists to work to? Because nowadays, you know, you can find some vocals on Splice, but everyone's got them. And a lot of labels won't even release music if the vocals from Splice, because they know there could be 10 other records without 100 other records. Do you have any tips?
I've done the same thing. I've grabbed vocals and I'm like, oh, this is great. And then a promo will come out and I'll be like, same vocal. Vocalists, there's... It is hard, and especially getting vocalists that are songwriters. So that's the point of where I'm at the moment in my career, is I'm basically, you know, I've got really good vocalists that I can go to, but then some of these vocalists can't write great songs. They can write okay songs, but if you're looking for hit songs, you want vocalists that or songwriters that come up with amazing melodies as well. So it's quite a difficult scenario when you're wanting to really go for those hit songs. But I mean, there is things like Sound Better, which is I think linked with Spotify, and you can post up what you need in a vocalist, and you can contact vocalists off that. And sometimes these vocalists, you can actually find them off Sound Better and, you know, contact them through Facebook. I mean, I do a lot of research on vocalists. I can spend days on vocalists. Yeah. The hard thing is, if you're a beginner guy with no following, a lot of these guys, they're not going to get in contact with you. If you've got money, then perhaps you might get some guys that go, okay, yeah, you know, the song's okay, we'll do something. You know, there's guys that will, vocalists that will do stuff for money. It's also Fiverr. I could keep going back to Fiverr, but Fiverr, you can actually find
for vocalists.
Yep.
Wow.
Yep, you can find vocalists on Fiverr. I think Fiverr should pay me for giving them name dropping them all this time. But definitely, and there's session musicians on Fiverr that I actually use as well. for strings or brass or guitar or bass. Sometimes depends on what project it is. And, and vocalists, I've used, I haven't used a lot of vocalists off there, but there are vocalists there. And some of them, you can get them for, you know, $50 or something like that. It is definitely hard. And it, I mean, if you've got an idea already on a vocal and you just want someone to sing it, sound better, or Fiverr, or if there's a vocalist that you really like, you know, put together a couple of tracks, you know, get them to choose something if they like it. But then, you know, you're going to need to have that business end of things, because some of the bigger vocalists, you know, they're going to have management, and you're going to have to deal with some of their management and all this kind of stuff. So what I was saying about the contract stuff, you know, you need to have a little bit of that in the back of your mind when attaining your splits that you're going to do with the vocalists. So I think Sound Better is pretty good, and I've connected with a few from there. I've even, I mean, I research hardcore, where I've even gone on to Splice and found out who some of these singers are from the packs, and gone and messaged some of the singers. So, I mean, I really go into, you know, research mode, and it will take me days. And, you know, I do a lot of covers as well. And some of my covers, I want the vocalist to sound exactly or very, very similar to the original vocalist. And it will take me days. For instance, I did a cover of Red Hot Chili Peppers' Other Side about 4 or 5 years ago. And I found a lot of Red Hot Chili Pepper vocalists on YouTube. So YouTube's also another good place to start to find guys. But I found a lot of the guys could do the Red Hot Chili Peppers rapping really well and sound like Anthony Kiedis. But when they were singing, it's just terrible, you know. And it took me, I think, about 3 days scouring the internet for days and days, and I found a Russian cover band. And the guy, the singer from this Russian cover band, sounds exactly like Anthony Kiedis, and he's Russian.
Wow.
And so you just, you know, basically negotiate a rate with them, and then bang, go and record, and there you go. So I think YouTube's really good. And I also did one for Michael Jackson Thriller, and trying to find anyone that can emulate Michael Jackson is probably one of the hardest vocal missions you can do. And I found a guy from Spain, and he's absolutely amazing. But then obviously trying to get the publishing clearance on a cover version for Michael Jackson, incredibly hard, but we did it for Thriller. I think I'm the first ever artist in the world to officially cover Thriller with the original writer's blessing, Rod Temple-ton, and also Michael Jackson's estate gave their full blessing on it. So
that's YouTube, incredible.
It is incredible, and I'm a huge Michael Jackson fan. YouTube, very good place to start. Sometimes SoundCloud, Sound Better is good for vocalists, and Fiverr, you can find some cheap vocalists on there for sure. You can find some other songwriters on there. It's definitely worth going on there and just, you know, I spend days sometimes doing it, and it pays off.
Awesome. That's brilliant. I mean, yeah, Sound Better is something I recommend to people, but the notion of looking for you through YouTube, that's great as well. I'm going to link to all of these services below as well, like Fiverr and Sound Better. And yeah, Fiverr, I'd never even thought vocalists on that. So
it's crazy. And for organic instruments, if you're, you know, you're needing a guitar or something, you know, I have while I've been in lockdown, I can't get in with my guitarists from Melbourne or my other session musicians. So some guys on there will actually offer like a Zoom call service as well. And for producers like myself that already have an idea of what I want the guitar lick to sound like, you know, I can play it on my keyboard, but it, you know, you really can't get a, like for muted guitar, you can kind of get an okay sound, but you can never get that organic guitar sound, you know, and just their little frills and stuff like that they're doing there, especially palm mute stuff. It's incredibly difficult to get a very good palm mute sound for guitar. Like if you're looking at doing like Purple Disco Machine style of music, he heavily uses that palm mute stuff. So I think a lot, I'd say probably 60 or 70% of his stuff's organic music, like live bass, live guitar, all that type of stuff. So Fiverr, if you find the right guys, it can be quite good.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a great tip. Yeah, trying to get organic like bass guitar or real guitar from a sampler like Kontakt, you can never do it, you know.
I have luck with my bass because you've got Kontakt, you know, there's some really good bass patches you can get on Kontakt. Yeah. The Rickenback is a good one.
That's amazing, that one.
The Pro Bass, I think, is another one. Obviously Trillion, you know, that's got some amazing stuff in there as well. So that's really good for bass. I find I'm pretty good on bass, just writing and stuff, you know, but I always find if you're doing like that Purple Disco and New Disco kind of style, he will never ever use a synth guitar thing. He will make his bass. I guarantee some of his basses, he's probably just played on his keyboard because, you know, that I think you can, with the programming and all that, you can do all your good slides and all that. But I just find with the organicness and the texture of guitar, you just can't replace it. I mean, I've got a guitar in the studio and I could probably just sample myself playing one note at a time and it would sound better than some of the guitar plugins that I've got, you know.
Right. Yeah, I revoke what I said about bass guitar. Doing that with something like the Rickenback is definitely more successful than trying to recreate a real guitar, for sure. Yeah,
I love the ability that you can put all the slides in and all that type of stuff. So you can treat it like a real bass. It's just going to take you a lot longer in programming all that, and that's the hard thing. And that's what, if you're really going for that, then it's going to take you hours. If you don't have hours, go to Fiverr, because you can find guys that, you know, they'll just jam that stuff out. Have you heard of a guy called Davey 504?
I haven't.
He's like the biggest bass player on YouTube. He's got millions and millions of subscribers. But anyway, he hires a lot of bass players on Fiverr as well, and they don't know that they're being recorded on this thing, and he does all these, you know, see who's the best bass player that can replay his bass riff and all this type of stuff. So there's a lot of actually amazing bass players and for reasonable prices as well.
I'll check it out. Davey 504.
Yeah. He's the biggest guy on YouTube.
Awesome.
For bass.
Yeah. Cool. So I think the last question that we've got asked, I think we covered loads of really useful stuff today. The only other question is, do you have any other tips for beginners or intermediate producers hoping to make a living from music?
Making a living from music, yeah. It's taken me a long time to get to that point. Learn the piano. Learn some keys. I'll give you another thing which is really good, is melodics. Have you heard about that one, melodics?
No. Is that melodics with an X at the end?
No, I think if I got it down here, it is just melodics, just normally. And I think there's some free lessons that they give you, and they test you for your rhythm and your timing, and then they do your scales, your for all the different keys, and then they start. You can even learn how to do finger drum program, finger drumming and all this type of stuff, and they set you on your level of beginner or intermediate or whatever, and it just really hones your skills. So I find I used to play piano when I was in my teens, and I lost the competition and gave up the piano and took up drums instead. But I wish I never ever did that, because piano it's just, you know, the basis of music, it just comes off from there, you know, and if you know how to play the the keys and you can do all your bass lines and all your harmonies and all that stuff. So I think that is the main thing, is learn one of these.
Okay, cool. And I'll link to that Melodics website as well below this video.
Melodics is really good. If you do link to Melodics, you should hit them up and say, hey, give me 5% off from every one of my guys that joins.
Yeah, I will. I will. I'll check that out. But yeah, I think piano, I totally agree that piano is such a good fundamental instrument to learn for all of music. But I wish I knew guitar as well, actually.
I mean, I've seen your little quick cut of your scale, with your scales, how you put your notes from the different key, from the different scale and the side of your thing. So you've basically got everything that, you know, you can't be wrong if you're in that scale, which is quite a good trick as well. I don't really use Ableton that much. I have been using it a lot lately, but I absolutely hate the MIDI side of things. I love all the easy auditioning of loops and all that. I love that. But I just find, and because I'm a Logic boy, but I just find I have to bounce everything from Ableton and then go into Logic, or I will have my vibe and then I'll just bounce the vibe from Ableton and then go into Logic and I'll write everything in Logic and then I'll bounce it out or export MIDI and then I'll take that back into Ableton. So I'm actually cross DAW at the moment, because I do find there are some really cool effects racks in Ableton as well, which, you know, for different sorts of music, you can get some really great effects, which I find is just a nightmare in Logic. So I kind of just bounce between the two at the moment.
Okay, yeah, each has their strengths for sure.
But I do like your little chord trick.
Yeah, I think they copied me. I was doing it, and now Ableton 11 has got that feature. I mean,
oh really?
So,
that's the EDM tips trick there.
There you go. But it's cool because now you can select all these weird like Eastern scales, rather than just the simple scale. So it's really cool, that feature in Ableton 11. Logic's going to be better for some things, but now you can comp vocals in Ableton, which was a massive weakness before. You couldn't do that.
Right.
Now you can record multiple takes, much like you can in Logic, and then comp the best takes. But anyway, getting a bit geeky now. But Now, Joel, thank you so much, man. We really appreciate the time that you've given today, and I know that it's going to be very useful for a lot of people.
Well, hopefully some of you guys can take away some of the advice, but yeah, just, you know, stay true to yourself and write lots of cool music and learn the piano, and you know that's definitely going to help you in the long run as well.
And once again, congratulations on your massive success with Dreams. I'll link to Jolyon's channels below this video. So if you haven't checked his music out yet, make sure you do.
Thanks so much, man. Really appreciate it. Take it easy, guys.
There you go, guys. I really hope you've enjoyed this video. I know it's a bit of a switch up from the norm, but I'm very excited to say that I'm also soon going to be interviewing the head of A&R at Anjuna Beats. So if there's anyone else you want me to interview from the industry, any producers, any record labels, any heads of A&R, anything like that, let me know in the comments below this video. If you haven't already, smash like if you dig and subscribe to the channel. And until next time, cheers and happy producing.